Dr. Rouse, thank you for joining us. If we look at the past month, there were more than 900,000 jobs created. What drove the rehiring? And given this momentum, how do you still make the argument you need trillions more in taxpayer spending?
Yeah, no, the jobs number that we got yesterday that suggested that over 900,000 jobs were created last month is such great news. It suggests that the economy is slowly starting to reopen. We still have a long way to go. We still have 8.4 million jobs fewer than we had this time last year. I personally believe that what this reflects is this accelerated speed with which we've been rolling out the vaccinations and which people have become vaccinated, the confidence that people have that we can see the light at the end of the tunnel. But I do want to highlight we're not there yet. This was, we had a dramatic loss of jobs over the past year, and the pandemic is still with us. We still have the variants. So this was fabulous news, but we're not quite there yet. You know, the second part of your question was, well, why do we need the American Jobs Plan on top of this? Well, the American Rescue Plan was about getting to the end of the pandemic. That's what it was. It was a rescue. It was to ensure that people had money to put food on the table, pay their rent, that businesses had some money to try to get through to the other side, that the state and local governments had the resources they needed to get us to the other side of this, and to support the dissemination of the vaccines in the first place. The American Jobs Plan is fundamentally about saying, okay, we've got an economy which, is doing okay. So we're back to what an economist would call full employment. But we need to do better. This country has not been investing in our infrastructure, in our R&D, in our workforce for decades. And we will not continue to be able to grow our economy to ensure that we've got the maximum amount of capacity out of our economy as possible and that growth is widely shared. We will not remain the number one economy in the world unless we make these critical investments at this time.
If you look inside those jobs numbers, as you indicate, there is some variation here. For Black Americans, the unemployment rate's 9.6%, nearly 8% for Hispanics versus 5.4% for whites. Why are minorities still lagging?
Well, that is exactly what the American Jobs Plan is meant to be trying to work on. So even a year ago, when our overall unemployment rate was 3.5%, it was almost twice that for African Americans and for other workers of color. Those are the structural inequalities that have existed in our economy for decades, if not, for the last century. And so that's exactly what we need to be rectifying. We need, in order to have the maximum economic growth possible for us to be a prosperous society, we need to put all workers to work to the maximum, to their capacity, to do their best. We need to make sure that our workers have the kinds of education and training that they need. And we need all hands on deck. So yes, those inequalities are there. We do know that as the economy picks up, our workers of color will benefit as well, but we need to be addressing the structural inequalities along the way as well.
When it comes to inequality, women have suffered a large share of the job losses, but it looked like it improved in March. Is that because schools are reopening for in-person?
That's what I believe. Yes, it's we know that women have disproportionately borne the brunt of this downturn, dropping out of the labor force at record numbers. And that's largely because they needed to take care of their children, whether it was just take care of their children because daycares and schools were closed, or for those children learning remotely to be able to help them, playing the role of teacher and mother and sometimes trying to hold a job while doing so as well. What we saw in the last month is that there was an improvement in labor force participation that was entirely due to women. And at the same time, when we look at the job gains, it was widely shared. So there were gains across the economy. And in particular, we saw that there were gains for educators in both the private sector and the public sector. So I do believe that the improvement in women being able to participate in the labor force is due to the fact that schools are starting to reopen.
So inside this jobs bill that the Biden administration is pushing, there's about $25 billion for building or upgrading child care centers and expanded tax credits to incentivize child care centers being built by private employers. How is this supposed to work? Is this taxpayers subsidizing private child care companies? And where do small businesses fit in here?
Well, look, what this what the jobs plan recognizes is that care is an important part of our infrastructure if workers are going to be able to go back to work. So the idea here is that we need to have quality child care centers that are available for parents across the country. And we know that there are locations where there are very few child care centers available. So the idea is to provide incentives for people, for child care centers to be built where there are none, and also for employers to develop their own child care systems so that it makes it that much easier for their workers to be able to drop off their children, know that their children are being well taken care of, while they're able to also work outside the home and do the kind of work that they find fulfilling or that they want to do.
But what about paid leave? Because we heard on the campaign trail, we've heard from the Biden administration, this is a goal. Why was that left out of this proposal and the last one? I know there's some temporary support in there, but is your calculation that women can wait?
So paid leave is part of the American Rescue Plan, and that rescue plan is by definition temporary because it's meant to get us through this pandemic. So it's for the next year. Some of the provisions last for another two. The president is committed to paid leave. As you know, the American Jobs Plan is the first part of a two-part plan. The second part will be rolled out in the coming weeks, which addresses really supporting the American family. And so the president is very committed to paid leave because that is a critical component to allowing workers to balance their work outside of the home, their own health, as this pandemic has highlighted. Workers need to be able to stay home and take care of themselves when they're sick, or they need to be able to stay home and take care of a loved one without fear of losing a paycheck in order to be able to do so.
So paid leave will be in this upcoming bill. How big will that be?
So I'm not going to make news. So the president will be rolling out the specifics of the next plan in the coming weeks. But, you know, he's fully committed to those parts of ensuring we've got adequate health care, adequate education, and that families really have the supports that they need to be able to flourish in our country.
Well, let's talk then about the bill that the president is calling for in his proposal, this $2 trillion ask. Only about 5% of the funding goes to infrastructure. Viewers can take a look at the breakdown here of all the programs that are called for funding on. But of the $620 billion for infrastructure upgrades, it includes incentivizing purchases of electric cars. Can you honestly call this a focus on building roads and bridges?
So, you know, I think it's important that we upgrade our definition of infrastructure. We need a definition of infrastructure that does not meet the needs of the 19th century or 20th century economy, but one that meets the needs of a 21st century economy. And that means we need to be funding and incentivizing those structures that allow us to maximize our economic activity. So incentivizing electric vehicles is really important because we need to be addressing climate change. If we think about the opportunity cost of not doing so, we're just going to keep paying for it. And we know that we need to be encouraging our industries to be tilting towards, you know, greener production, greener technologies. So that's a piece of our infrastructure bill. All of it is designed to improve the functioning of our economy so that we can increase economic growth and make sure that that's widely shared.
But as you know, these other add-ons are what is going to also make it more politically difficult to get through Congress. President Biden is throwing around this projection that the entire bill will create about 19 million jobs. What does that number come from? Which industries are going to do that hiring?
So that's an estimate from Moody's Analytics, and we know that those jobs are going to be coming from the traditional infrastructure. We can just call it traditional, the roads and bridges. So the pipe fitters, the electricians, those who will be paving the roads and building the bridges. But we also know that some of it's going to be coming from research and development. So the scientists and engineers will be thinking through the innovations that will ensure that our economy is being smart and is developing solutions to the knotty problems that we need to solve if we're going to really address climate change and be prepared to continue to flourish as we go forward. I want to make a point that it's not just child care, but care is an important part of that as well. So if you think about it, Infrastructure are those components that allow workers to be able to go to work. So I need a road. I have to drive on a road to get to work. So a road is part of the infrastructure. Ever since, you know, the United States started, women have allowed men to go to work because women are providing the care at home for the children, for the elders. But now that men and women are in the labor force, we need for our loved ones to be taken care of. Otherwise, women cannot go to work, as this pandemic has highlighted. So he's also allocated $400 billion to improve our care. This is taking care of the 1 in 5 workers, which the Census Bureau has estimated over the coming decades will be a part of our population that'll be of retirement age. We know that the workers or our family members who are over the age of 85 are going to be a growing part of our population, and we need to take care of them. And so unless that's going to just fall on women, and you know, for those women who want to work outside of the home, we need to be providing them with the resources that they need to be able to do so, knowing that their loved ones will be taken care of.
That Moody's analysis says, though, in terms of jobs, with the infrastructure plan, the economy recovers the jobs lost in the pandemic by early 2023, but it's not much different than without the plan. The president has said raising taxes on corporations won't hurt the economy. He's talking about how to pay for all of this. But a slew of employers disagree. I'm sure you've seen these statements. Chamber of Commerce called this proposal dangerously misguided. They say the tax increases will make the U.S. less competitive. National Association of Manufacturers says it will fundamentally undermine our ability to lead this recovery. These are the employers that you need to create these jobs.
So I would have two things to say about that. So first of all, the president believes that everybody should be paying their fair share in taxes. But if we want to speak to the economics of a corporate tax, of our corporate taxes, let's first stop and consider what were the impacts of the Tax Cut and Jobs Act, the TCJA of 2017. Did we see a massive improvement in investment when we saw the corporate tax rate cut from 35% to 21%? The analyses that I have seen suggest not much. What we mostly saw were stock buybacks. We saw that the owners of those corporations got wealthier. Furthermore, in that Moody's analysis that you cited, looking over a 10-year plan, the analysis incorporates both the investment parts of the president's proposal, but also the corporate tax components as well. And on net, we see that there is an improvement in our economic growth. We see that there's an improvement in labor force participation. We see there's an increase in the number of jobs and a decrease in the unemployment rate. So net-net, we think that the president's proposals are good for the American economy, even including the corporate tax cuts. Including the corporate tax increases.
So the corporate tax rate, as you're indicating, it would go up to 28%, probably even higher than that. And taxes on corporate income earned overseas would also increase. This is 15 years of higher taxes to pay for 8 years of spending. Can you really say it's not a cost?
First of all, what I would say is that typically when one makes an investment, one pays for an investment up front, and there are returns that gather over time. Yes, there are, the tax cuts may extend further beyond the actual payment of the investments, but that's the way we would typically think about accounting when we're making an investment. And I would say that the reason why the president is proposing these corporate tax increases is because that's just the right thing to do. He believes we should be, we should be encouraging these corporations to pay their fair share. They all use the roads and bridges and the public goods that are going to be created by these investments, and they should be paying their fair share of the taxes in order for us to be able to do so.
I'm sure they debate you on what fair share is, but I want to also ask you about the political chances of this getting through. You have to persuade not just Republicans, but many Democrats. Speaker Pelosi herself has said she hopes that you will lift the cap on state and local tax deductions, the so-called SALT tax. New York Democrats are telling you this is going nowhere unless you do that. Will you eliminate that cap in the next bill?
So what the president has said is this, is that he believes that his proposal should be fiscally responsible, what's most important is that we make these very important investments in our economy, That we deal with our infrastructure, that we be reinvesting in research and development, that we be supporting our workers. He has a proposal for how to make that fiscally responsible. He is very open to other proposals for how to do so. So he's got a plan, but he understands Congress, he understands Washington, and his door is open, and he looks forward to working with Congress to finding a way to make this entire package work.
So he's still open to it? I mean, he was for it when he was on the campaign trail.
So what I can say is this, is that the president believes very strongly that these are once-in-a-generational investments that we need to make as a country together. He has a proposal for how he can offset those costs. But if others have other ideas that they want to bring to the table, he is open to it. He believes that the investment should be offset. He believes it should be fiscally responsible, but he will have his door open, and he looks forward to working with Congress to finding ways to offset the cost.
And lastly, this past week, we had a number of corporations weigh in on this controversial move in a number of states to change voting rights laws. The president said that he would like to see the All-Star game move out of Georgia. And then the very next day, Major League Baseball did just that. Is the White House urging corporations to use their economic power to take political positions? And is part of the fallout from this, these boycotts, also going to hurt employment for low-wage workers?
Well, look, the president has said very strongly that he is opposed to these state laws restricting voting rights. He's called them the Jim Crow of the 21st century, period. In terms of these companies, they are exercising their right to vote with their feet. It's a little early to judge what the economic impact will be. They have a right to vote with their feet and to express their dissatisfaction with the laws.
But for a popcorn stand worker in Atlanta who just learned he's not going to be hired in July, I mean, this comes at a cost, does it not?
There is undoubtedly going to be a cost. I think that was the point that the Major League Baseball was trying to make. Major League Baseball will, however, move its game. And workers at another place will benefit. That is exactly the message that Major League Baseball was trying to send. The president opposes these laws. He believes that they are restrictive, they're discriminatory. These companies have the opportunity to vote with their feet, and they're using their economic power to express their dissatisfaction.
Understood. Dr. Rouse, thank you for your time today.
You're very welcome. Thank you for having me.